In today's class, we'll be learning about prism and the effects that it produces when light rays incident on it. So let's start off with that. So prism. So here we'll be mostly learning about triangular prisms. We'll be dealing with triangular prisms. So we'll be representing it like this. Although it is a three-dimensional structure, you can actually understand a prism to be in this particular manner. So it looks something like this. So it has two triangular faces. So as you can see, this is one triangular face and this is one triangular face, and it has three rectangular faces. So we can say two triangular faces and it has three rectangular faces. So if you have to define, we can say that it is basically a transparent medium. The whole prism would be made up of generally glass or any other material which is transparent, right? So it is a transparent medium in which the refracting surfaces are inclined with each other. So that is how we can define what a prism is. So as you can see, we'll be dealing with cases where light is incident on this surface and it passes through this surface after refraction. For example, let's say if light ray is incident in this manner at some angle, if I draw a normal here, this will be the angle of incidence, right? So this light ray, after refracting from this surface, it enters into the prism and it travels in some manner like this, and it gets incident on the second surface over here. So basically, if I name this, if this is A, this is B and this is C. So here we can say that AB and AC are the refracting surfaces, and we can consider BC as the base of the prism. So I'll write it down. So AB and AC are refracting surfaces and BC is the base of the prism. So that is the basic idea. So now in this particular scenario, so we call this particular angle the angle formed between the two refracting surfaces. So this is one plane refracting surface and this is the other plane. So the angle formed between those two planes, which is this angle, so this angle, we generally represent it with A. So let me write it down. So this is A, and A is called angle of prism, and sometimes it is also called as refracting angle. Okay, so these are some things which you will have to know about a prism. So now let us understand what are the effects that a prism creates whenever light ray passes through it. So we can say that the major properties of a prism are these two. We can say that these are the properties of prism. So first one is that it is deviation, and the second one is dispersion. Okay, so we'll learn about dispersion at the end of the topic. So initially, most of our discussion would be based on deviation. You would have observed this also. The major function which you would have seen for a prism is that whenever light is incident on it, if white light is incident, you would observe that from the other face, different colors will be separated out. So for example, if I consider a prism like this and if light is incident, so which contains all the colors in it, VIBGYOR. So if it contains all the colors, we call it as white light generally. So by the time it refracts inside the prism and comes out, you would see that all the light rays, all the individual colors or wavelengths will get separated. So you would see that as a colorful beam coming out of the prism. So we'll understand about all those effects. So you would observe that they'll be separated in this manner. V would be at the bottom, I, B, so on, and R would be on the top. So we'll also understand what is the reason for that. Why is the light ray getting divided or separated into different parts? So this idea of spreading out into different angles or spread over an angle, which is this. So this property is what we call as dispersion. So as I told you, we'll be learning about this at the end. So initially deviation, you know deviation, what deviation means. It basically means that if light ray is incident at one particular angle, the final light ray that is coming out of it will be at a different angle. So in this particular case, you can see that. So the light ray is incident in this particular direction, whereas the light rays coming out are at different it is in the different direction. So which means, so this light ray was deviated onto the different side, different direction. So that property is what we call as deviation. And as I told you, we'll be initially learning more about deviation and later on about dispersion as well. So these are some things which you'll have to know about a prism. So just remember that it is just a transparent medium in which the two surfaces are inclined at some angle which is lesser than 90 degrees, clear? And that angle is what we call as the angle of prism. So let us try to understand now what are the parameters which we use for. So let us now understand the deviation produced by prism. So deviation in prism. Okay. So if I consider a prism, so this is called as the refracting angle as we discussed earlier, and let us consider that there is a light ray which is incident at this point. So a light ray is incident in this manner, so we can call this as the angle of incidence, right? So this is the normal. Okay, so let's consider that the refractive index of this prism is some mu. So we know that the outside medium here is air, and this is a denser medium in this scenario, right? So this outside medium is air and this is the denser medium. So as light ray enters, so it undergoes refraction, and we know that it bends towards the normal. So this light ray after refraction, it bends towards the normal, and let's consider that this angle which is formed over here, let's call it as R1, right? So angle of refraction at this first surface, right? Now this light ray will go and strike the second refracting surface, so which is this. And if I draw a normal here as well, so the normal would be like this, and there is an angle which is formed over here, and I can consider that this angle which is formed will be the angle of incidence for the second surface. So let me call it as R2, right? Okay. Now this light ray after refraction from this surface, we can say that it comes out in this manner. And if you observe, I have drawn it away from the normal because it is entering from denser into rarer medium. So instead of going like this, it is bending away from normal. So this is the angle of incidence. So this angle we are calling it as R1, and the angle formed here, which is the angle of incidence for the second surface, is R2, and light finally comes out making this much angle with second normal, clear? So we can call this angle as E, and E basically means angle of emergence. So I'll write it down. E is angle of emergence. Okay. So now we are required to find the deviation that the light ray has experienced in this scenario. So as you can see, this is the initial direction in which the light ray is traveling. So it was traveling in this direction, but it has undergone some kind of effect here. It has undergone two refractions, and eventually it is traveling in this direction. So I can say that the angle between this initial direction and this final direction, so instead of going like this, it is finally going like this. So the angle between these two is what we call as deviation experienced by light ray. So to understand that, I'll just extend this incident ray further like this, right? And I'll also extend this is the emergent ray, so I'll extend this as well in the backward direction like this. So I can say that this is the direction of incident ray and this is the direction of emergent ray. And if you see, this is the angle between the incident ray's direction and emergent ray's direction, correct? So we can call this angle which is formed over here as the angle of deviation. So we represent it with delta. So delta will be the angle of deviation. So now we need to find out what the value of delta is. So if you observe, you can say that here the angle is I, this angle is R. Now we can say that this line and this line are cutting with each other. So if this angle is I, can you say that this complete angle will also be equal to I, correct? So this complete angle will be I, and here this small angle here is R1, which means this angle will be I minus R1, correct? Now similarly, if you look on the other side, so this complete angle is E, which means this complete angle will also be E, out of which this is R2. So I can say that this angle, how much will that be? E minus R2. So this would be E minus R2. So that is the idea. So now if you look at, let me name some points here, let us call this as P, this as Q and this as R. So if you look at the triangle PQR, so this one, right? So this is I minus R1, this is E minus R2 and this is delta. So can I say that these two are interior opposite angles and this is the exterior angle? So we know the relation already. I can say that sum of interior opposite angles will be equal to, so that will be equal to the exterior angle, right? So based on that, I can write the value of delta should be equal to I minus R1 plus E minus R2. So I minus R1 plus E minus R2. So that would be the expression. So if I simplify this further, I can write this as delta is equal to I plus E minus of R1 plus R2. So that is the expression which we get for deviation, clear? Okay. Now, there is also another way in which we can write the deviation if we analyze this further. So if you observe carefully in this diagram, so this angle, we know that this is equal to A, correct? So which means if you look at this complete angle, so this complete angle which is formed over here, you can easily tell how much that angle would be, this complete angle. How much would that be? We know that this is 90 degrees, right? Out of which this is R1, so which means this angle would be 90 minus R1, correct? Now similarly, you can do the analysis on the other side as well. So I can say that I'll draw it over here. So if I take this angle, how much will this angle be? Same as that. So we can say that if you see here, I can say that this is 90 degrees, correct? So between the refracting surface and the normal, the angle will be 90, and this is R2, which means the remaining angle would be 90 minus R2. So I can say that here this angle would be 90 minus R2. Clear? So I want you to draw this diagram. Make sure that the diagram which you draw is little bit bigger so that it doesn't become very much clumsy, right? Like I have done here. Okay, so I hope you are getting that. So this complete angle is 90 minus R1, this complete angle is 90 minus R2. So if you look at this triangle which is formed, so this triangle, we know that the sum of the three angles should be 180 degrees, right? So if I write that condition, I can say that this is 90 minus R1, this is 90 minus R2 and this is A. So I can say 90 minus R1 plus 90 minus R2 plus A is equal to 180 degrees, correct? So that is the expression which we would be getting. So I've just added the angles and equated that to 180. So now 90, 90 and 180 will get cancelled out, and if you simplify this, if you send minus R1 and minus R2 to the other side, you would be getting A is equal to R1 plus R2. So this is a very important result. So what this basically means is that I'll draw a separate diagram so that it is clear. So if we have a prism like this, and if the angle of incidence is I, so the angles made inside the prism with the normal, so this is R1, we have considered it as R1, and the other angle with the normal we have taken it as R2, and this is emergence, right? So what we understood is that this sum of two angles, the angle that the light ray makes with the two normals inside the prism, which is R1 and R2, the sum of these two angles should be equal to the angle of prism. That is the result which we got, and as I told you, this is a very, very important result. So now, if you combine these two, so you can replace the value of R1 plus R2 here with A. So I will eventually get the value of delta as I plus E minus A. So this is the final expression which we will be using for the angle of deviation. So this is angle of deviation, angle of incidence, angle of emergence minus the angle of prism. So that is the expression for deviation produced by a prism for a light ray which is incident on it. Clear? So here we can actually write the expression for that deviation as well. So which we'll write in a well, because we know that it is just undergoing two refractions, correct? So there is one refraction here and there is another refraction here. So we know how to find the deviation produced by a single refraction. So whenever we have a light ray which is incident at some angle, so let's say there is a light ray which is incident at an angle I, and if it refracts into the second medium at an angle R, so we know that the value of delta produced in this scenario is nothing but I minus R, right? We have discussed this already. So by using the same concept, we can calculate what the value of deviation is in this particular scenario. So let's see that. So I'll write Snell's law at both the surfaces, because this is just normal refraction, correct? So refraction is occurring here and as well as here. So I'll write Snell's law at this surface and at this surface and check what the value of net deviation is. So let's see that. So refraction at first surface, okay. So you know how to write Snell's law. So surrounding outside medium is 1, and the medium here has a refractive index of mu, right? So I can write 1 into sin I is equal to mu, this medium has a refractive index of mu, so mu into sin R1 into sin R1, correct? So that is one equation. So sorry, mu into mu. So that is the expression which we would get. So simplifying this, from this I will be getting the value of R1. So if I write the value of R1, what is the value of R1 I will get? I can send this mu to this side, I will get sin I by mu, right? Sin I by mu is sin R1, which means R1 will be sin inverse of sin I by mu. So that is the expression which we get for R1. Now similarly, I can also find R2 by writing the equation here, right? Let us write the equation for that as well. So refraction at second surface okay. So at the second surface, mu into sin R2, clear, is equal to outside is 1 and angle is E. So what can I write here? So mu into sin R2 is equal to 1 into sin E, correct? So I can write the value of E is equal to mu sin R2. Okay, this is sin E, right? So I can write E is equal to sin inverse of mu times sin R2, correct? Okay. So if I have to write the value of emergence directly, because if you look at this particular expression, the value of deviation. Deviation is I plus E minus A. A is a constant, correct? I is something which we can adjust. We can adjust the value of I depending on what the case is required. So, this E is the one which we will have to find out, correct? So, in from here I found the value of R1. So, what I am going to do now is to find the value of E, I need R2, correct? I do not know R2 also, but I know this relation. I know A is equal to R1 plus R2. So, which means I can write this expression as E is equal to sine inverse of mu times sine of A minus R1. I just replace the value of R2 with A minus R1. Okay. Now, in this particular expression, I have R1 and I know the value of R1, right? So, if at all they ask you in any situation, if they ask you to find out, if they give you the angle of incidence, refractive index and the value of A. So, all you need to do to find out E, you do not have to remember this relation, none of the relations which I am writing now is, it is not required for you to remember, but you just need to know the process and the process is pretty simple. All you need to do is write Snell's law at this surface and Snell's law at this surface, rest is just simplification. So, Snell's law here and application of these two results. So, these are what we will require throughout this whole chapter. Apart from this, there is nothing else required. So, we will be applying Snell's law. We would know that A is equal to R1 plus R2 and deviation is I plus E minus A. So, these two and writing Snell's law would be sufficient for throughout this chapter. So, do not look at these expressions and think that they are very difficult and nothing, there is nothing like that basically. So, these are all pretty simple, just Snell's law, Snell's law. So, that is what I have done, right. So, I got the value of E. So, if I need to write the expression for deviation delta, we know that the value of delta can be written as I minus A plus E, correct, plus E. What is the value of E? E can be written as sine inverse of mu times sine A minus R1. What is R1? R1 is this. So, sine inverse of sine I by mu. Okay. So, that is the expression which we would get, correct. So, as I told you once again, this is something which is not needed. You do not need to remember that. Once again, I am stressing it once again, you do not need to remember this equation. All we have done here is Snell's law, Snell's law. A is equal to R1 plus R2, delta is equal to I plus E minus A. So, just keep that in mind and this is not required. So, what we will be doing here is to understand deviation, we will not use this expression, but we will be using the graph of this expression. So, if you see here in this particular expression, except for I, everything else will be constant. So, this is basically the expression for delta as a function of I, clear? So, this is delta as a function of I. So, which basically means that if I keep changing the value of angle of incidence, the deviation also continuously changes. So, if you see everything else is constant, A is constant, mu is constant and yeah, those are the only terms which we have. So, this is basically the function of deviation in terms of I and so, as I told, we will be just understanding the graph of this expression and analyzing that graph. So, this expression is not required for us, clear, but remember how we derived it, that they can, questions can be asked based on that. So, we will see, some examples on that also, clear. So, students, now we will see some examples based on what we have discussed and calculation of deviation. So, let us take a situation like this where we have a prism which is an equilateral prism. Equilateral prism basically means the angle of prism is 60 degrees, clear. So, you know that if this is 60, we can say this and this will also be 60, because if they do not mention about these angles, we can always say that this is an isosceles case. We can directly assume that, clear. So, if this is 60 and if this is isosceles, then these two should be equal. So, which means 60 each, clear. Okay, so that is the case given to us, and they have given that the refractive index of this prism is root 3, right? And there is a light ray which is incident on this prism at some angle, so which is equal to, let us say, some 60 degrees. So, angle of incidence is 60, angle of prism is 60, and the refractive index is root 3. So, we need to find out the value of deviation in this particular scenario. So, as I told you, the long expression which I have earlier written, you do not have to remember that. So, just observe what we will be doing. I will just write the basic expression, which is for delta, that is I plus E minus A, correct? So, I know I know A. So, if I am able to find the value of E, I can easily calculate the value of deviation. And how do we calculate E? We know that this light ray undergoes refraction, bends towards the normal, it forms an angle R1 and it strikes the second surface at some angle R2 and then it comes out in some direction like this. So, we know that, so this angle here with the normal is E, correct? So, we need to find that angle. So, as I told you, to calculate the value of E, we just need to write Snell's law at this surface and at this surface, that is it. So, you can see that if I write the Snell's law at this surface, what is the expression I would be getting? So, surrounding is by default air. So, air, so 1 into sin 60, so 1 into sin 60 is equal to, here the refractive index is root 3, so root 3 into sin R1, correct? So, if I simplify this, we have root 3 by 2, root 3, so root 3 and root 3 by 2 will get, root 3 will get cancelled and I will get the value of sin R1 as 1 by 2, correct? So, which basically gives us the value of R1 is equal to 30 degrees. Now, this angle, we know that we understood that this is 30 degrees, we know this angle is 60. Now, you can easily tell what this angle is. How much would that be? We have just earlier derived that R1 plus R2 is equal to A. So, 30 plus 30 should be 60. So, which means even this angle here will be 30 degrees, correct? So, which will imply the value of R2, which is equal to A minus R1, is also equal to 30 degrees, right? Now, we can write Snell's law at the second surface, clear? So, this is for first surface. So, if I write Snell's law at second surface, so light rays incident at an angle of 30 degrees on the first surface and it is coming out, on the second surface, and it is coming out at an angle of E, correct? So, if I write Snell's law once again, I can say root 3 into sin 30, which is 1 by 2, is equal to, the outside medium is air and angle is E. So, 1 into sin E. Correct. So, if you simplify this, so we can say that sin E is equal to root 3 by 2, which would give us the value of E as how much? Root 3 by 2, so 60 degrees. So, I got the value of E, see, I do not have to remember that expression, correct? So, all I need to do is just write Snell's law at both the surfaces. That would, using that and the basic relation that A is equal to R1 plus R2. So, we can find out any given, any asked value. So, that is the idea. So, I know all the values now, I can substitute that here. So, when I substitute that, so we know that I is 60, E is also 60 minus A is also 60, and if you simplify this, you would get deviation also as 60 degrees. So, this is one such special case where everything turns out to be 60 degrees, I, E, A, and deviation also is 60 degrees, clear? So, that is how we solve cases related to deviation, okay. Now, let us see one more question. So, this time let us try to understand, draw the path of the ray, draw the path of the ray, clear? So, this time let us take a prism which is like this, So let's consider that this is a prism which is having an angle of 120 degrees. So angle of 120 degrees, right? And let us consider that the light ray, and it is an isosceles prism. If nothing is mentioned, we can consider that it is an isosceles prism, which would mean that this angle and this angle are equal, right? So how much would that be? 30 degrees and 30 degrees. Okay. So now a light ray is incident on the first surface. So let us draw a normal first. So if I draw a normal, so this is how it is. So light ray is incident in this manner. Let's consider at an angle of 60 degrees. So light ray is incident at 60 degrees, right? And the refractive index of this prism is also root 3. So we need to now plot the we need to draw the ray diagram for this light ray. So what types of effects does it undergo inside the prism, right? So we need to mention all the angles and everything. So let us first write the equation here. So this is rarer medium and this is denser medium. So we know that light ray will always enter into the denser medium, right, irrespective of whatever the angle of incidence is. So light ray enters into this medium at some angle, so which is R1, that is how we generally consider it. So this angle here would be R1, correct? So let us find the value R1. So if I write Snell's law here, what do I get? Outside medium is air, so 1 into angle of incidence is 60, so sin 60 is root 3 by 2, correct? This should be equal to, here the medium is having a refractive index of root 3 into sin R1, right? So simplifying this will give me the value of R1, root 3 and root 3 gets cancelled, 1 by 2, so which means R1 is 30 degrees, okay, right? So which means if I draw a light ray from here making an angle of 30 degrees, let us say it is something like this. So if this angle here is 30 degrees, so this light ray goes and strikes here, correct? But if you observe closely, this angle here is 30, which means this angle should be 60. Now we already have, if you look at the upper triangle which I have drawn, I have 120 degrees here and I have 60 degrees here. They both put together is already 180. Then how come there is an angle being formed here, right? So this is something which you should be observed. What does that mean? Is there any mistake in the calculation that we have done? No, I have just applied Snell's law at first surface and I got the angle of refraction as 30 degrees, right? So this is 30 degrees, so I have done everything correct. So this is 30, which will mean this is 60, this is anyways already given in the question. So how come then this light ray is striking here and making some other angle? So here the assumption that we have considered, which is this light ray goes and strikes this surface, is not going to happen. So that is the mistake here, clear? So by looking at the angles which are formed, this is 60 and 120, we should immediately understand that it is already 180 here. So there is already 180 degrees formed here, which means this should not form a triangle here, correct? So the diagram which I have drawn here is not correct, so I will erase that. So what is going to happen in this scenario is that this light ray, after entering into the prism, will enter at 30 degrees and that would look something like this. It strikes the base of the prism, clear? So it strikes the base of the prism. So this is 30 degrees. Now this will be 60 degrees and this is 120 degrees. So that is what we will have to understand here. So this light ray, after entering into the prism, so it is not going to strike the second surface, right? It is going to strike the base. Now we need to further plot the ray diagram. So I will draw the normal here and look at what the angle of incidence is. How much would that be? How much will be the angle of incidence? How do I understand that? So this is 30 degrees, this is 30, we know that this angle here is 90 degrees, right, because this is the normal. So 30, 90, 30, so this whole angle is 120. So this is 120 plus 30 is 150, and there is one angle which is left here. So how much should that be? 30 degrees, 30, 30, 120, correct? So this angle is 30. Now if that angle is 30, how much will this angle be? 60 degrees, correct? So 60 degrees. Now you should be careful, because the angle of incidence is 60 degrees and the light ray is incident from a denser medium onto a rarer medium. So this medium is denser and this medium is rarer. So what do we have to do now? Can I directly refract it outside? We will have to check whether refraction takes place or TIR takes place. And you all know the condition of how to check whether TIR takes place or not. So I wrote this in the earlier class. So mu 1 sin theta 1, if it is greater than mu 2, then TIR takes place, correct? So that is what I will have to check here. So let us consider this is the first medium, which is having a refractive index of mu 1. So if I write the equation, so let us check. So this medium has a refractive index of root 3 and the angle of incidence is 60, which means mu 1 sin theta 1. So root 3 into root 3 by 2, right, at base. This is at base. So we are checking the condition for TIR, correct? So this should be greater than the next medium's refractive index. The next medium is just air, so greater than 1. So now we will have to check whether this inequality is correct or not. So if I check this, 3 by 2 is greater than 1. So 3 by 2 is greater than 1, which is correct. So which means TIR takes place. TIR takes place. So that is what we will have to understand. So which means this light ray, which is incident at an angle of 60 on the base, will once again get reflected back. It gets reflected in this manner, in such a way that this angle is 60 degrees as well. Clear? So that is the basic idea. So this is the incident ray. So is the question over now? No, because this light ray is actually going and striking the next surface once again. So once again we will have to analyze what happens at that surface. So let me draw a normal. So this is the normal and we need to find the angle of incidence. So we know this is 30, this is 30, which means this whole angle should be 120, correct? So if that whole angle is 120 degrees, we know this is 90, so which will make this angle 30 degrees. Clear? So the angle of incidence is 30 degrees in this scenario, and the light ray in this case will come out, making an angle of E. So that E is what we will have to find out, correct? So let us write the equation for the third surface. So this is for the first surface, this is for base, and this is for the second surface, the second refracting surface. Okay, so for third surface, I can write, so the refractive index is root 3 and angle of incidence is 30 degrees. So root 3 into sin 30, so angle of incidence is 30. So sin 30 should be equal to surrounding medium is 1, outside medium is 1 into sin E. So solving this will give me sin E is equal to root 3 by 2, which means the value of E is equal to 60 degrees. So that is the final result which we would be getting. So this light ray finally comes out at an angle of 60 degrees. Clear? So that is what happens in this scenario. So you should be very careful. So you will not be given many cases like this, but remember that something like this can also happen. Don't directly consider that a light ray which is incident on one face will definitely go on to the other face. So check that properly, and then you will be able to, if you draw the diagram clearly representing all the angles, you will definitely understand whether this light ray after refraction goes on to that surface or this surface. So based on that we can understand the next step. Clear? So they are just asking us to draw the path of the light ray. So this is how it would be. So the light ray travels like this. This is the incident ray. It enters into the prism in this manner and it undergoes TIR at this surface. It travels in this manner and eventually it refracts and comes out like this. So that would be the path of the light ray. Clear? So students, now we'll analyze the graph between the deviation and the angle of incidence. So the big expression which we have derived earlier, so that can be drawn in the form of a graph. So I'll plot that graph here. So on the y-axis, I'll represent the deviation produced or deviation experienced by the light ray, and on the x-axis we'll have the angle of incidence. So if you plot the graph, so it would be something like this. So a curved graph, something like this. It is not a parabola because you know the expression which we have, it is a sine inverse function, right? So it is something similar to that, clear? So it, the graph looks something like this. Now so I'll, so in this particular case, this is how it looks like, right? So this two points which I have drawn a line for, so this represents the maximum deviation. So this is something corresponding to delta max, and this is something corresponding to the minimum deviation. So this is delta minimum. Okay, so now what we are going to analyze from this graph is, for what values of for what values of incident angle will we get maximum deviation and minimum deviation. You can see from the graph that, so this is one value of I where the deviation is maximum, correct, and this is another value of I for which the deviation is maximum. So I'll name these points as I1 and I2, angle of incidences as I1 and I2, and you can observe that delta minimum is occurring at this particular value, which is let's call it as I itself. So I'll let I naught, right? I naught is the angle of incidence at which minimum deviation occurs, and I1 and I2 are the angles of incidence at which maximum deviation occurs. So this is how the graph would look like. So you don't have to worry about how this graph occurs. As I told you, that is the reason I have derived that big expression, to show you that it is basically a function which is in which involves sine inverse and parameters like that. So plotting that would look something like this. So you can understand that this was plotted by using many experimental observations. So for one particular value of I, you find deviation, for another value of I, you find deviation, and you can plot this graph, right? Now, so from this graph, there are some observations that you have to make out. So I'll first list out the observations. The first one being, minimum deviation, which is delta minimum, occurs at only one angle of incidence. Correct? You can see that from the graph, the smallest value of deviation is basically the tip of this curve, right? So that tip is occurring at only one particular value of incidence, whereas if you look at every other deviation from minimum to maximum, if you look at any other deviation, for example, let's say this value of deviation. So this value of deviation occurs at two different values. So it occurs at this value of I as well as this value of I, correct? Except for the minimum deviation. So minimum deviation occurs at a single value of angle of incidence. So this is something which is very important for us in the further analysis. Now, the second one, you can write delta max occurs at two values, and you can easily say what one of the value is, because you can see that the graph ends here. There is no further graph plotted on the other side, right? So delta max occurs at two values of I, of which one angle is, how much is that? I've told you this. So this is the value where I'm getting delta max, and the graph is not present after that. What does that mean? That basically means that this angle of incidence is the maximum possible angle of incidence. So if I consider a prism in this manner with this as the normal, so if you have different possible angles of incidence, What will be the maximum possible angle at which the light ray can be incident? That is 90 degrees, clear? So, this basically corresponds to 90 degrees. So, you can directly say that this is 90 degrees, clear? So, 90 degrees, which means grazing incidence, clear? So, I will write it down here as, or I will write it down once we discuss maximum deviation. So, that is the basic idea. Maximum deviation occurs at two different values, one is this and the other one is this, and this angle will definitely be 90 degrees. So, that can be understood from the graph. That is the maximum possible value of I, correct? Okay, so of which one angle is 90 degrees. And you can also say one more point. So, generally this curve is not symmetric, right? You can, I think you can observe that from the way that I have drawn, correct? So, the curve is not symmetric. The curve is not symmetric. So, this is another point which you will have to keep in mind. Remember, it is not a parabola. So, what happens is that, as you can see on the right side, if this is the minimum deviation, onto the right side of the deviation, the curve is more flatter, right? And on the left side of the minimum deviation, the curve is more smaller, I mean it is more curved, whereas on the other side it is more flatter. So, that is how you should understand. We'll see what that implies also later on. So, just I am trying to say that if this is how it is, if I exaggerate this, it looks something like this, clear? So, this is just an exaggeration of what I have drawn. So, on this side, if this is the minimum deviation, so on the left side of minimum deviation, we have small value, and on the right side of minimum deviation, we have a larger value. So, that is how the graph actually looks like, clear? Okay, anyways, so these are some observations which we will have to make from this particular scenario. So, now using these ideas, let us now derive the expression for maximum deviation, right? So, let us calculate maximum deviation. So, we already know that maximum deviation occurs at two different values, one is 90 degrees and the other angle is not known, right? So, that is what I am going to find out first. So, it occurs at two values. So, maximum deviation occurs at I is equal to 90 degrees, which can also be called as grazing incidence. Correct? So, that is the basic idea. So, now let us try to find what the other angle is. So, which is this angle? So, this I 1 which I have drawn here, right? So, that is also the other angle which corresponds to maximum deviation, correct? So, I already know I 2 which is 90 degrees, I need to find I 1. So, let us understand that. So, for that what I will do is I will take a prism. So, this is the normal. And I'll first draw the ray diagram for this scenario, right? The grazing incidence scenario. And I know that in the grazing incidence scenario, the light ray undergoes maximum deviation, right? So if I take a light ray which is incident in a grazing manner, so which means this angle is 90 degrees, right? Let us consider that the angle of prism is some A, the refractive index is some mu, right? So, we know that the light ray enters into this medium like this. So, let us say this angle, you actually know at what angle it enters. What is that? Remember that this is a light ray which is incident in a grazing manner entering into a denser medium. How does it enter? It enters at theta c. You can directly say that the angle here will be theta c. Okay, anyways, so theta c. So, on the other side, so, if I draw the normal once again, we can find out this angle as well. How much would that be? We know that this angle plus this angle, this plus this should be equal to A. So, A is equal to R 1 plus R 2. So, based on that we can say if this is theta c, this would be A minus theta c, right? So, this is A minus theta c, and now the light ray comes out from here in this manner. So, let us say this is, this angle is E, Clear? Now, if you see here properly, I can say that this is the direction in which the incident ray is incident, which means it is along the first refracting surface, and the light ray is finally coming out in this manner along this direction. So, if I extend this light ray and this light ray to make them touch each other, so I will just extend this emerging ray backwards like this. Clear? So, this is the incident ray's direction, this is the emergent ray's direction. So, I can say that this angle which is formed over here will be delta max. I hope that is clear. So, maybe I will draw it little bit darker. Okay. So, that is the idea, right? So, this is incident ray's direction, this is how it is traveling, and final ray is traveling like this, and this is the angle. From here it is deviated through this angle. So, this angle will be delta max. Now, our concern is what is the other angle of incidence. So, here we know that for this particular angle I 2 is equal to 90 degrees, we get maximum deviation. So, now we need to find this value, right. So, what is this value which is I 1. So, that is the value which we need to calculate. So, observe carefully here. So, when light ray is incident at 90, it is coming out at E. Okay, fine. Let me just ask you a scenario like this. Same prism, and what happens if light ray is incident at E? Think of that scenario. Here the light ray is coming out at E. What I am doing now is I am making the light ray incident at an angle of E. Whatever E we got here, if the light ray is incident at that angle, what is going to happen? What happens is that, what I am basically telling you here is, the light ray is just incident in a reverse manner. So, incident ray, emergent ray. What happens if light ray is incident in the opposite direction of emergent ray? You know this already, we discussed about this concept called reversibility, right? So, what does that mean? That the light ray follows the same path and it comes out at, it comes out in the way in which the light ray was actually incident. So, what happens in this scenario is, the light ray just travels like this, and after refracting from this surface, it comes out in this manner. Clear? So, I have just drawn the reverse of this, that is it. So, here in angle of, here I is 90. And angle is, emergent angle is E. Here I is E and the emergent angle is 90. So, that is the only thing. So, can I say that in both the cases we get the same deviation because this is just the reverse of this. So, you can understand that the same ray if it was incident in this manner, it would travel in this manner and come out in this manner. You do not need the next diagram also, right. So, if I just interchange the values of E, if I make sure that the angle of incidence is E, I will automatically get the angle of emergence as 90 degrees. So, that is the concept of reversibility. So, can I say that for 90 if I get maximum deviation, for E also I should get maximum deviation, right. So, that is the other value which gives us maximum deviation, and we can easily calculate the value of E by writing Snell's law at both the surfaces. You can easily write Snell's law. Here we have theta c, we know that this is a minus theta c. So, can you find out the value of E here? I want you to do that. I want you to write Snell's law at this surface and find the value of E, clear, at which maximum deviation occurs. So, I leave this to you. I hope all of you will be able to do that. So, I have already shown you that this angle here is theta c, this angle is a minus theta c. All you need to do now is write Snell's law at this surface and find the value of E. So, what we can say is at 90 whatever is the deviation I get, at E as the angle of incidence also I get the same deviation. So, it basically means that this I 1, I can say that is The angle of emergence, angle of emergence for I is equal to 90 degrees. So, we can understand it like that. And this is the exact same reason why we have two sets of values for each and every deviation. For example, for if I consider this deviation. So, this deviation is occurring at two angles. One is this angle, let us call it as I dash, correct? And the same deviation is occurring at another angle, if I call that as I double dash, if I call that as I double dash. What can I say is the relation between I dash and I double dash? In this particular case, I can say that, where shall I write that? I will write it here. So, in this particular case, I can say that I dash and I double dash. What can we say is that I double dash will be the angle of emergence, the angle of emergence when angle of incidence, angle of incidence is I dash. Clear? So, when angle of incidence is I dash, whatever is the angle of emergence, for both the angles of incidence, we get the same deviation. So, I dash and I double dash will give us the same deviation. So, those are the two sets of values in each and every scenario. So, to finally summarize this case of maximum deviation, we can say that maximum deviation occurs at two angles of incidence. So, one case is this, one case is when the light ray is incident in a grazing manner, and the second case where we get the same deviation is for this is, let us say this is the first case where that occurs, and I can say that the second case where that occurs, what is that? It is the case of grazing emergence, correct? Grazing emergence. So, that is exactly what I have explained you in this case, whether the light ray is incident in a grazing manner or whether the light ray is incident in a manner that the emergent ray is coming out in a grazing manner, then in both the cases we get maximum deviation. Is that clear? And to calculate that maximum deviation, we can just write Snell's law at both the surface, find the value of E, and then I plus E minus A will be the maximum deviation. So, please understand that what the two sets of values here represent. If one is the angle of incidence, the other one will be the angle of emergence for that angle of incidence. Clear? So, those two sets of I will give you same deviation. So, students, now we will discuss a question based on maximum deviation which we have just discussed. Okay. So, this is a prism with angle of prism being 75 degrees. They are asking us to find delta max, and they are also asking us to find the values of angles of incidence at which delta max occurs. Clear? So, they have given the refractive index of that medium as root 2. So, we know that one of these angles is definitely 90 degrees. So, there is no need to worry about that. I can directly say I 2 is 90 degrees, and I also know I 1. I 1 will be the angle of emergence when angle of incidence is 90. So, that is what we have discussed earlier. So, let us try to find out. So, what I will do is I will take the normal first. So, because of delta max, we know that I can directly consider the grazing incidence scenario. So, let us say this is the angle of incidence, I mean the incident ray. So, this angle will be 90 degrees, and now the light ray enters into this medium and strikes the second surface. So, what would this angle be? We can write Snell's law, right? Or you know that it is equal to theta c, because it is incident in a grazing manner, it will be equal to theta c. So, you can write directly the value of theta c, or you can use Snell's law, both will give you the same result. So, because we anyways know that this is theta c, and I will directly write the value of theta c. What is theta c? It is nothing but sine inverse of mu of rarer medium, which is 1, divided by mu of denser medium, which is root 2. So, sine inverse of 1 by root 2 will be 45 degrees, right? So, the light ray enters into this medium at 45 degrees. Clear? Okay. So now this light ray goes and strikes the second surface. So if I draw a normal here, so this is how it looks. And because we know that this angle plus this angle is equal to 75 degrees, so this is 45, which will make this angle 30 degrees, right? Now the light ray after refraction from here will emerge in this manner, making an angle of E. And we can say that if this 90 degrees is taken as I2, then this E will be the I1. I hope you understand that. So the values, two values which I am looking for, I1 and I2, will be the angle of incidence and angle of emergence in the same case. Clear? Okay. So I need to find E. So let us write Snell's law at the second surface. So if I write it, I will be getting root 2 into sine of 30, sine of 30 is 1 by 2, is equal to surrounding medium. So surrounding, I mean outside medium is having a refractive index of 1 and into sine E. So when I simplify this, root 2 and 2 will get cancelled, root 2 will be left here. So sine E is 1 by root 2, which implies the value of E is equal to 45 degrees as well. Clear? So in this case I can say that the value of I1 is 45 degrees, because I got the value of E here as 45 degrees. So now I need to find delta max. So we know how to find the value of delta for any scenario. The formula which we have for deviation is I plus E minus A, correct? So let's substitute. So I is 90, right, 90 degrees, plus E. E is how much? We just derived that it is 45 degrees minus A. A is given as 75 degrees. So if I simplify this, how much would we get? 90 plus 45 is 135, 135 minus 75 is 60 degrees. So that would be the maximum deviation that the light ray can undergo. Clear? So that is how we can understand. So do not worry about all the expressions which we are writing. The expressions would look lengthier when we write them, but when we write the equations, when numerical values are given to us, writing the equation is just Snell's law. Snell's law at this surface, Snell's law at this surface, and the basic concepts of prism, which is I plus E minus A is delta, and A is R1 plus R2. Clear? The students, let us now talk about minimum deviation, right? So we have seen maximum deviation and how to calculate that. So now we are going to talk about how or when minimum deviation occurs. When, in the sense, for what value of I does minimum deviation occur, and what is the value of that minimum deviation. So these are the values which we are going to discuss now. So at what angle of incidence does minimum deviation occur, and the value of minimum deviation. Now, I have written earlier in the observations that for all values of, for all values of delta, there are two angles of incidence at which we get the delta, except for this one. So why is it so? Why am I getting the value of minimum deviation at only one particular value of I? So what does that mean? So let us understand that by drawing the prism. So in a prism, we earlier have seen that if light ray is incident at an angle of I, if it undergoes refraction and if it comes out at an angle of E, right? Whatever is the deviation in this case, clear? Or let me call this as some I dash and this one as E dash, clear? So in this case, we have understood that for I is equal to I dash and I is equal to E dash, we get same deviation, correct? So this is what we understood by using the concept of reversibility. So if light ray is incident in this manner and comes out in this manner, whatever is the deviation, same will be the value when light ray is incident in this manner and comes out in this manner. So that is what I have written, right? So under such scenario, we are getting a particular value of deviation for two different angles of incidence. But if you see this angle of deviation, it is occurring at only one angle of incidence, correct? So, what does that imply? It implies that this means that minimum deviation occurs in a case where the value of I is equal to E. So, that is the reason why we are getting only one single value. The reason is minimum deviation is occurring when I and E are the same. So, when I and E are the same, what is going to happen? For example, let us say if this is 30 degrees, if the light ray is also coming out at 30 degrees, then if I make the light ray incident in this direction, the angle is still 30 degrees. So, that is what this means. Is that clear? So, the reason why we are getting only one value is because I and E have become equal at that particular case. We know that I and E will give me the same deviation, correct? But in this case, we are getting only one value of incidence for delta minimum, which means I and E should be the same. I hope this is clear. So, that is what I have written here. Minimum deviation occurs in a case where the value of I is equal to E. Clear? So, now using that concept that I is equal to E, we can find out what the value of minimum deviation is. So, let us try to analyze that scenario. Let me write some more values here. Let us call this as R1, this one as R2. Now, if you see, if I is equal to E, can I say R1 should be equal to R2? Why is it so? R1 and R2 should be equal to each other. What is the reason for that? Because if I write Snell's law at this surface, I would write sin I is equal to mu sin R1, correct? If I write Snell's law at this surface, I would write mu sin R2 is equal to sin E. Now, we understood that I and E are same in minimum deviation scenario. Clear? If this is equal to this, then this should be equal to this, which would imply R1 and R2 are same, correct? So, see, the idea is pretty simple. For example, let us say if this is 45 degrees and this is also 45 degrees, if light enters, let us say at some 30 degrees. So, if light ray enters into the medium from 45 to 30, if it is incident at 30, it should come out at 45, correct? So, that is the reason we can say that I is equal to E implies R1 is equal to R2. You can directly say that, or you can also understand that by using Snell's law. Clear? So, these are the two conditions for minimum deviation. I will write them down here as well. At minimum deviation, we can say I is equal to E and R1 is equal to R2. So, these are the two observations that we can say in the case of minimum deviation. So, now if I apply that to find minimum deviation, we know that deviation can be written as I plus E minus A, correct? So, I would be getting this as I plus E. E value is nothing but I, E is nothing but I minus A, correct? So, that is the idea. So, if I simplify this, I will get the value of delta minimum is equal to 2I minus A. So, that is one equation I would be getting. But remember, from what we have started off, I need to find I as well as delta minimum, right? I would know the, for example, if I take this prism, I would know the angle of prism, I would know the value of A, and I would know the value of mu, let us say. So, I know A and mu, I need to find I and delta minimum. When will minimum deviation occur? as well as how much will be the minimum deviation. Both have to be calculated. So I have one equation, I need to write the other equation, and the other equation would be Snell's law. I can write Snell's law at this surface, right? So if I write Snell's law, I would be getting sin I 1 into sin I is equal to mu into sin r1 you can say. So r1. Now one important thing which you'll have to keep in mind is that I'll maybe write it here itself. R1 is equal to R2, let's say is equal to R. Let me call that R1 and R2 both are R. Now this would imply that we also know A is equal to R1 plus R2, correct? And this would imply that A is equal to R1 and R2 both are equal to R. So both are same. So from this I can say that the value of R is nothing but A by 2. So that is the expression I would be getting. So that is also an important result. So the implication of this is this, right? So if R1 and R2 are same, because R1 plus R2 should be equal to A, it means that each one should be equal to A by 2. So I can use that result here. In place of R1, I can directly substitute A by 2, correct? And that is it. So if I substitute the value of I from here, so from here if I substitute the value of I, I would be getting sin of delta minimum plus A by 2 is equal to mu times sin A by 2. So that is the idea. So if you need to find delta minimum, this is the equation we would be using. So you don't have to remember this as a result. I am telling you once again, you don't need to remember this as a result. Just keep in mind the conditions for minimum deviation. So the condition for minimum deviation is that I is equal to E, R1 is equal to R2 is equal to A by 2, and then you can directly write Snell's law, clear? So this is the idea. And once you get delta minimum, you can substitute delta minimum and find I as well, clear? So if you know delta minimum, you can find I as well. So that is the basic idea here. So some important points you'll have to know here are basically written here. So let us now solve a question based on minimum deviation. So here they have given us an equilateral prism, right? So the refractive index is given as root 3. They are asking us to find the delta minimum and also the value of I at which delta minimum occurs. So you can directly use the formula which we have derived, or like I told you, you don't need to remember that also. You can directly write the Snell's law equation, which is pretty simple to write also. So I'll write Snell's law. So here the first thing we need to understand is that, so because this angle is 60 degrees, so if let's say light ray is incident in this manner, if this is the I for minimum deviation, so if the light ray enters into this medium, I can immediately say that this angle should be 30 degrees, because we know that R is A by 2 in minimum deviation scenario. Not just this, even on the other side also will have the same 30 degrees, and by the time it comes out, the light ray comes out at the same angle at which it is incident, correct? That is what we have discussed. I and this should be same, I should be equal to E, and R1 should be equal to R2 should be equal to A by 2, right? So now you can directly write Snell's law at this surface, clear? So if I write Snell's law here, I will be getting 1 into sin I is equal to sin 30 into root 3. So root 3 into sin 30, sin 30 is 1 by 2. So when I simplify this, I will get the value of I as 60 degrees, and this will also be equal to the value of E, correct? Now if you need to find the value of delta minimum, delta minimum is nothing but in any case we can say that delta can be calculated by using I plus E minus A. So if I substitute the values, I 60, E 60, A is also 60, and solving this will also give me 60 degrees. Clear? So this is the first case which we have discussed. So that will also be the minimum deviation that the light ray experiences in that particular scenario. Clear? So that is the idea. So if you want, you can also calculate what is the maximum deviation that the light ray experiences in this case, and you know how to do that, right? So make sure that the angle of incidence is 90 degrees and just write the equations for light ray and find the angle of emergence when angle of incidence is 90, and after that you can find delta max, just like I plus E minus A. So students, that would be the end of today's lecture. In next class, we will solve some examples based on the prism, and we will discuss few more concepts on prism.